Hi class, today we're going to continue with our factoring using our two-question process of first asking is there anything in common and then asking how many terms. In the previous video we took a look at the answer to our second question of how many terms, and we took a look at the answer of what if there were two terms. In this video, we're going to begin the process of what happens if there's three terms. There's always going to be either two terms, three terms, or four terms for the problems that we're doing in our particular class. So let's start with three terms. If there's three terms, there's going to be two different cases, and we're going to need to know whether we have one case or if we have the other. So we're going to look at the general form for something that is in three terms. It's going to be in the form where you have some number a times the term that's squared. We're going to use x for our variable in this particular situation, and then some other number times the term that's raised to the first power. So you have x squared, and then you have x, and then you have your constant, which we're going to call c on the end. This particular problem right here is what we call a quadratic, and that's because our highest exponent is a 2, and the values in front of the variables here, a and b, and then the constant on the end, c, are always going to be called a, b, and c every time you see something that's a quadratic like we see here. And the a in the beginning is the one that we're going to look at to determine how we deal with a three-term thing that we're trying to factor. If a equals 1, you're going to be able to do a shortcut, which is what we're going to discuss in this particular video. So you're going to hope that a is 1, because if a is 1, you're going to have a nice, neat, quick way to factor your problem. If a is 1, your problem will have your variable squared plus some value times your variable to the first power plus a constant on the end. And an example of something like that would be x squared plus 8x plus 15. Notice that the coefficient out front is a 1. We normally don't see the 1 when there is a 1 as a coefficient, and because there's always an implied 1 in front of the variable. The coefficient in the second term is an 8, and our constant on the end is a 15. Now, to see what to do with this particular problem, we're going to examine a problem we might have multiplied in our previous chapter. For instance, let's say we had x plus 2 times x plus 3. If we were to multiply this in our previous chapter, we would have foiled, and we would have done x times x is x squared, and then x times 3 would be 3x, and then 2 times x would be 2x, and then 2 times 3 would be 6. And then we would combine our like terms here in the middle, and we'd end up with a 5x here, a 6 here, and notice that we have an x squared out front, and this is in the same form as our problem that we have up here, where we have an a as 1, so it looks like this right here. Now, notice that the reason why a was 1 was because the two values we multiplied that were the first items in our parentheses were both x, and they both had a 1 as their coefficient. So x times x gave us our 1x squared right here. Now what we're going to examine is how did we get this 5 and this 6, and how does that relate to the original problem up here to see what we should do with this particular situation over here. Notice that the 6 came from multiplying the last things in the parentheses here. 2 times 3 gave us this 6. And at the same time, the 5 as the coefficient here came from adding the 3 and the 2, which are the last things here. So since this has a 1, we know that whatever this variable is, that's going to be the first thing in each parenthesis. And then what goes as the last things in the parenthesis are going to relate to this item right here and this one here. because they're going to multiply to be your constant on the end, and at the same time they're going to add up to the value that you have for a coefficient in the middle. So what we want to do in order to answer our question of how to factor the x squared plus 8x plus 15 is we want to ask ourselves what multiplies to get c and at the same time adds up to b. The answer to this question will tell us how to factor this particular problem. We know since we have an x, we're going to make two parentheses, and both of those parentheses will have a first term as an x because we had r1 right out here. So now we need to take a look at the c, which is 15, and ask ourselves what would multiply to get 15 and at the same time would add up to 8, because those numbers will tell us what goes into the last spots of these two parentheses. And I notice that 15 is 3 times 5, and 8 is also 3 plus 5. So since both those are positive, I notice that I'm going to have a plus 3 in one parentheses and a plus 5 in the other parentheses. And that is going to end up being what our original problem is up here. Factored, it will look like this. Now the great thing about this is you can always check your values. You can check your factors by multiplying them back out. So if we wanted to check this, we could do x times x and we would get x squared. Then we'd do x times 5 and we'd end up with a 5x. And then we'd do 3 times x and get a 3x. And finally, 3 times 5 is 15. Notice that the middle terms are going to add up to our 8x, and we're going to end up with the original problem. And since we did that, we know that these factors are correct. Now, let's take a look at another problem where it might not be quite as easy to see what multiplies to get our c and adds up to our b. So I'm going to go ahead and erase this, and we're going to take a look at another problem. Now, one thing that a lot of people have problems with is our positives and negatives, and oftentimes our positive and negatives can change what values we want to choose when we're doing this factoring process on our shortcut. So you need to be a little bit careful. So let's say that we have x squared minus 13x minus 30. Now, a lot of you might be looking at this and saying, well, 30 is 10 times 3, and 10 times 3, if we take those two values and add them up instead of multiply them, we're going to get 13. But you need to be careful. Don't go quite so fast, because this 30 over here on the end is a negative 30, because the sign in front of it goes with it. So we need to take into consideration the combinations of positive and negatives, because to multiply and get a negative value, one needs to be positive and one needs to be negative. If you can't see the values right off the bat, what I would suggest is off to the side, write your negative 30, draw a line under it, and then list all the pairs of things that multiply to get negative 30. So we have negative 1 times 30. Notice that's going to add up to positive 29, which is not what we want. We also have positive 1 and negative 30. That'll add up to a negative 29, which is not what we want. So if we continue on, 2 times negative 15, and we also have negative 2 times positive 15. And notice how I'm going to systematically go up from 1 to 2 to 3 and so on until I have all of them listed. So the next thing that goes into 30 is 3. We have 3 times negative 10 and negative 3 times positive 10. And then 4 doesn't go into 30, but 5 does. So we have 5 times negative 6 and negative 5 times positive 6. When you get to where the two values are almost identical, or they are identical, you know that since you've gone systematically up from 1, you've got them all listed. Now notice if we had chosen our factors of 3 and 10, we would have ended up with either a negative 7 if we added them, using the 3 and negative 10, or a positive 7 if we had added the negative 3 and the positive 10. So 3 and 10, even though looking at this you'd want to instantly say, is not necessarily the correct one. Notice that right here, 2 times negative 15 was negative 30, and when we add those two values, we do end up with the negative 13. So we are going to choose 2 and negative 15 as our two values. 2 times negative 15 is our negative 30, and 2 plus negative 15 is our negative 13. So for our answer, we're going to have an x as the first item in each of our parentheses, and then our second item, one of them will be a positive 2 and one of them will be a negative 15. And those are our two factors. Now, sometimes you have this shortcut, but it doesn't necessarily look like it. The way you can tell if you have this shortcut is to always make sure that you ask this first question up here, is there a common factor? Sometimes you can do the shortcut, but it's kind of disguised by the fact that something is in common that divides into everything. So let's take a look at a problem like that. Let's say that you have a problem that happens to be 2x squared plus 14x plus 24. Now, at first glance, you would look at this coefficient right here and say, that's not one, I can't do this shortcut. But you have to remember that first question and notice that this 2 out front here divides evenly into everything in the entire polynomial. So we're going to actually factor that 2 out first, and then we might find that we actually can use this shortcut we learned. Factoring the 2 out, 2 goes into 2x squared, a positive 1x squared. 2 goes into 14x 7x times, and 2 goes into 24 12 times. Notice that if we look at this polynomial here that we have after we've factored out our 2, this does have a 1 out here, and we can do our shortcut. So now we ask ourselves what multiplies to get 12 and at the same time adds up to 7. And I notice that 3 times 4 is 12, and 3 plus 4 is 7. So that means the two values we're going to use in our two parentheses are 3 and 4. You need to carry down the 2 out front, and then you're going to have an x, since that's our variable, as the first item in each parentheses, and then a positive 3 in one of them, and a positive 4 in the other. It does not matter what order your parentheses are in, as long as you have both of them. And that's how you go ahead and factor using, if you have three terms, using the shortcut, and